don't forget you are my darling. Don't forget to be all you mean to me. Non dimenticare, my love is like a star.
Hi, I'm John Solari, your host of The Method Actors Speaks, and today we got a treat for you. Our lovely, lovely actress from Italy we got coming over here to do her one-woman show. Her name is Dina Maroni, and I really want to welcome you. I saw Dina at Salome's one-woman show about Anne, which was a gift to watch. But really, I before we get into your play, I mean, I want to know, you know, about you, why you got into acting a little bit, so that we know who you are.
Okay. Well, I'm Italian. I come from an Italian family, immigrants, Italian immigrants. They live in Canada, but they're from Calabria in southern Italy. And my grandfather was the big showman. He was always putting on little shows and little plays. And it was all about singing a song and dancing the tarantella and doing some silly thing. So I started performing as a small child at home in the kitchen. And just never thought that that would be something that would become a professional thing for me. I just thought, oh, this is a lot of fun and this is a hobby. And then I started taking it seriously and took acting classes and went to school and studied. And it kind of really all started from my, let's say, my dysfunctional Italian family and all the craziness. I had to go do something with it.
Really? Dysfunctional. You know, the Greeks invented the theater, but the Italians, I don't know if you know this, invented the stage.
No.
That's right. We invented the stage. Somewhere to put it.
Yeah, our kitchens.
Yes. But I also, we the show is dedicated to the love and memory of Susan Strasberg. And you studied with Susan in Italy, if you want to talk a little bit about that.
Yes. I was working in Rome, Italy, for many years. And one day I heard that Susan Strasberg was coming to Rome to do a master workshop. And went to the class, and when she went around and asked everybody who they were and what their experience was, I put my hand up and I told her who I was and that I had studied in Los Angeles with Bill Traylor and Peggy Fury at the Loft. And Susan began to cry, and I didn't know the connection between Susan and Bill and Peggy. And I knew it later once I read Susan's book, but I didn't know it at the time.
What was the connection?
And the connection was that they were all best friends, all from, you know, the actor's studio. And she was very, very, very close to Peggy. And so when I mentioned that, Susan had tears in her eyes and stood up and turned to the entire class of Italian actors and said, "This girl studied with." And from that moment on, Susan and I just were very close, good friends, and she became my teacher, my mentor. She was in Rome doing many of these workshops, and she would show up with her two suitcases, and I had a big library full of books, all in English, and I would pick out scenes and monologues for all the actors, translate them from English to Italian, and Susan and I would go over who would be doing what and which person would be better for which monologue or which scene. And so I worked with the actors, and Susan was the teacher, and I did the simultaneous translations during her teaching, and we just became very close because of that. And she was a great role model, great inspiration, but not just as an acting coach, because she was incredible as an acting teacher, because she had such a strong, warm heart and such a strong sensibility. I mean, she really got people, but she was just such a funny human being with such a great, great, just vibrancy. She was just wonderful.
Yeah, she was a wonderful talent and sorely missed. And, and why wouldn't she? I mean, she grew up with the world's greatest actors.
And, yes.
I mean, being the daughter of Lee Strasberg and that group that used to surround her. I mean, I taught acting, and I used to tell students, I remember this woman was crying in the scene. I told her, "You don't cry." And she comes from these classes where they think that's acting.
Yeah.
And I said, "Well, don't listen to me. Listen to Shelley Winters, because what I'm telling you is coming from Shelley Winters. I'm not coming from me. You make the audience cry. You don't cry."
That's right.
You know? And And I used to, and the things that Susan and her brother John, who was another one,
he is.
You know, I used to see him at the studio in New York, and from the back it was like looking at Lee.
Yeah.
But a wonderful moderator. Now, how do the Italians adapt to the method?
Oh, the Italians love the method. They love the Actors Studio. That's all everyone talks about. In fact, it didn't take much for Susan to come to Italy and find professional actors who wanted to study with her. The list was very long, because the minute they heard that it was Susan Strasberg, that it was, you know, the Actors Studio, it was the method, people signed up. And she also had the right personality. A lot of people have tried to go over there to teach different techniques, and they just didn't have the following Susan had. She also had she also was Susan Strasberg. She was also Lee's daughter and Paula's daughter.
She's
and
the princess.
Yes,
of
and
the method.
Well, also people in Italy know Susan. The great directors in Italy, they knew Susan. They knew Susan's work as a performer. Right. So she was very high. She was very much in demand. They wanted her on television. They wanted her to be on shows to interview her. She had a great time there. One time, this is an interesting story. Susan and I, we were talking about her father and the influence he had on her life and different things through her acting and through her teachings, because I never worked with Lee, but there was just a feeling. I've read many of the books. There was just a feeling that I had that Susan had this sensibility and this intuition that her father had. And one day we had spent the day talking about this in her class. And that afternoon I was in Rome and I was going to have a bite to eat, and I was on my way to Susan's. And I saw this man from behind, and he looked just like Lee. And I'd never met Lee. And then I walked in front of him and I went, "Wow, that really looks like Lee." And I kept turning around and I said, "That really looks like Lee." And so when I saw Susan, I said, "Susan, I know this is strange, but I just saw your father. I know you don't believe me." And she said, "Oh no, honey." She said, I know he's out there. I know he's here." And it was the weirdest thing, because he looked just like Lee in Rome. Of course, he was probably some Italian man walking the street who looked like Lee. But there was just this whole presence that we both talked about it, because it was really powerful. She had that day, I guess she had been thinking about him and stuff had come up. And then I saw him on the street. It was just kind of a bizarre thing.
Now, how your play that we're going to really be, for the audience out there, they're really going to be delighted when they see. What is it about? Tell the audience.
Well,
and how it came about.
Well, how it came about was that I mentioned earlier, I lived and worked in Rome for many years as an actress. I did I hosted TV shows as well in English and Italian. I did commercials. I did print work. I did everything, basically. In all the areas of entertainment, let's just say, and including dubbing of films. And over the years, when Susan would come to Rome, she would say, "Honey, you've got to put this stuff up there. You've got to tell these stories," because I would tell her the stories of things that happened to me, and they were funnier than a lot of the material I was using in class. She was like, "Honey, you have to put that up there." And I just never did. So when I moved to Los Angeles, I got serious about writing stories that I told over and over again at restaurants or in class or at auditions, and I just started writing this stuff down. And I had a meeting with Federico Fellini years ago, just before he died, and I remember telling Susan the story, and it started from there. And then I would tell it at a restaurant, and people would go, "Wow, do you do a one-woman show?" And I said, "No." I'm like, "Oh, wow, that should really be in a one-woman show." So I started to put all these pieces together about a young, Italian-American girl who goes to Italy and tries to work in the Italian film business with all the perverts and all the people hitting on her. And she's just like, Alice in Wonderland, trying to figure it all out. And then she finally meets the maestro Fellini, and something happens in this encounter with Fellini, which is the piece that's the second act about Fellini. It actually is almost verbatim how the encounter went with Federico Fellini.
Really?
And then, of course, she does become like a diva star, like an Italian diva, like a bad Italian variety TV, and that's really not a claim to fame for her. But a lot of this is taken from my life, and a lot of it is taken and twisted, and some of it is taken from just stuff I can't resist because I know people's lives over there, or I have all this material, And so I put it together. Oh. And it's very funny. It's 1 hour. It takes you on a whirlwind roller coaster ride through Rome in this girl's journey through trying to make it in show business. But it's not really, it's not autobiographical. There are elements of it that are true.
Wow. Now, you've done it other places.
I performed it in town. I performed it. Am I allowed to say
sure.
where?
Sure.
I performed it already at the Westfest Theater of Original Works at the Theater West on Cahuenga Boulevard. And I performed it at the Lee Strasberg Institute on Santa Monica Boulevard in West Hollywood. And I'm currently...
hoping to bring it back there.
Yeah, I'm putting it... there are a few little elements that I need to... change and fix and do different things with, because every time you do it you go, oh gosh, that could be so much better, or I could really focus on that a little bit more. But the material it's all in Rome, so it's quite original. I don't know too many people who put on a show where they met Fellini and talked about it, so it's very original.
Now, how do you prepare for this when you do that? I noticed you were writing out
how do
outside
I prepare?
There. How do you prepare when you go on?
Wow.
Because you, now, since it's, well, you tell me, because what kind of method do you use? Or how do you prepare? That's what I really want to know.
That's a tough question, because I'm overwhelmed at times when I'm preparing, because there's so much to prepare besides just getting out there and doing the actual work.
What do you mean by overwhelmed?
It's just, there's a lot going on before the show that I like to know is correct. I like to know that things, just like every actor likes to know that their chair is going to be in the right place, that the lights are going to be in the right place, that my dress is there so when I go to get changed, it's there. So after all of this has, taken place, then I finally, makeup and hair, and I just sort of, I sit there and really, I go into a place of relaxation where my mind is clear of everything that it could possibly be clear of. Uh-huh. I just take everything out of it. And I have there are moments before I go on where I listen to, let's say, the music, or I just feel Italy, or I just feel certain things that are gonna bring me to this place, especially the beginning of my show, which is what gets the whole ball rolling. If I'm not in my body, if I'm not in Italy, feeling Italy at the time that my show starts, I'm not going to be there.
So we would say that's your choice.
Yes.
You make them big choice.
Big choice. I am in Italy. I'm on Italian soil. I feel the cobblestone streets, because she's in Rome right from the beginning. So I have to feel the... This is all sense memory stuff.
Right.
But I didn't want to say it, but it's all sense memory stuff. It's all, I feel the grit and the sweat from the heat in Italy on the street, the pollution. I feel the noise. I hear the noise, the traffic noise, the cars, the exhaust. And so the minute, and I feel the people's vibes and energy, I feel all the confusion and the traffic, so that by the time I'm up there, I've already been, I've been going through.
You're ready to go right now.
I am. When can I begin? So basically that's how I, and I have this piece of music that, it's not the music that gets me going, but the music is there right before, and it all takes place, and it's a song from Rome, and it just couldn't be any more Roman than this song. It's all about Rome, and
is that the one, Dean Martin? Or?
Well, Dean Martin is the song that starts my piece off, but the one that just precedes it, which is an Italian Roman folk song, that's the one that gets me going. But no, I have to feel all of that. Before I go on, I have to feel all of this, because otherwise it's just Dina on stage telling a story.
We got to get Jerry Vail to get in touch with you. Really, some of his songs. Oh,
yeah.
Wonderful Italian songs, too.
Yeah,
you hear that, Jerry?
No,
Jerry Vail.
I have this whole way of that part of it, getting into it.
And that's wonderful.
And it works. One time I remember this specifically, I wasn't quite into it. I was worried about other stuff that was going on, and I wasn't quite feeling certain vibrations and certain things, like the pulse of Rome. I wasn't feeling the pulse of
what
Rome.
What is the pulse of Rome?
Well, you know, just there's so much happening. There are people, there's traffic, there's noise, there's the church bells ringing, and there's so much, especially in the summer, the heat and the exhaust. The exhaust from the cars, and there's no air conditioning, and you just have to feel all of this. You're sweating, and there's some guy trying to touch you on the bus, you know. And this is all in my show.
Sounds like New York.
It's like New York.
Without the church bells.
Without the church bells and without the Italian pervs.
Well, you got the other perverts.
Yeah, exactly.
The trench coats.
The trench coat pervs. No, in Italy, they don't have to wear trench coats. But anyway, yeah, she goes through this whole... she's tormented because she's a Roman Catholic, but she's in Rome trying to do something that obviously is going against her, you know, her roots and her family back in North America.
Yeah, and now in Canada, now where are you from in Canada?
I was born in a really small city called Thunder Bay. Thunder Bay is on the tip of Lake Superior. It's in the middle of the map in Canada. It's 4 hours northwest or northeast of Duluth, Minnesota. So if you go to Duluth or Minneapolis, you go to Duluth and then you go keep going
Where's
north.
Where's the big Italian population?
The big Italian population is in Toronto.
Oh, Toronto.
But Toronto is in the same province. Toronto is down here and Thunder Bay is up here, and it's an 18-hour drive around the Great Lakes.
That's a long way. Because I know a friend of mine, Tony Dennison, he loves going up there.
Does he go for fishing and
hunting? No, he did. He was working up there. They do a lot of work up there, and he told me it's a really big Italian section up there.
Toronto has a huge, huge, huge Italian community. Just huge Italian community. Oh. And they have they have Italian programming there, Italian television.
Really?
They have Italian movie theaters. Lot
Tony Dennison, he's really Italian. He's from New York. He's on that new show, The Closer. You were talking earlier about you were worrying about all these things, like the makeup and this and that. And it's amazing. And my first thought was, when I come in the set here, I don't worry about that. You know, I tell, because I have trust in the crew here at Comcast or wherever I'm at. Okay, I'll leave it up to them guys.
Okay.
And every time I see the show, it just comes out wonderful. No, really, because I stay out of it. You know, they do the work, and they know what they're doing.
They're the makeup artists.
Right, and your clothes and everything there will be there if the people are there.
Yeah.
And it's just one less thing you don't have to worry about.
I guess I just like to know it's there.
Well, what would you do if it wasn't?
I just keep talking.
See,
I don't have a problem. I'm Italian. I can talk about anything.
But you wouldn't have to. So there it is. There's your answer.
I know.
I mean,
well, my
amazing.
Family was immigrated from Calabria. They didn't speak English. They immigrated to this small, really small town. And I don't know if people are familiar with SCTV, Doug and Bob McKenzie,
sure,
the McKenzie brothers. Well, that's the Great White North where my family lives. So it's minus temperatures are, you know, in the Celsius, minus 40, minus 50, minus 60. It's very cold.
Yeah.
And so my family lives there. They didn't really learn to speak English, so I speak to them in Italian. But the whole community there of Italians, most of them don't speak English well. But the first generation, like myself, my friends, all our parents speak in broken English.
My family, when they came to America, my grandparents, they weren't allowed to speak Italian in front of the kids.
Oh.
Because you were supposed to be an American.
Yeah.
So I never learned Italian. Because everybody had to speak English in front of the kids, you know.
Wow.
They thought it was the right thing to do. They were in America.
And in my family, my father said, "We're Italian. We speak Italian at home. When you go to school, you can speak English."
Oh, see, it was different when I was a kid.
Yeah, but my uncle, with his children, he was a contractor, and he said, "We're in America. We speak English now." So my cousins.
That's
had
what
to
it
speak
was.
English.
You know, when they first came, we're talking about from like the 20s, the 30s, and the 40s and 50s when they came over. You know, they came over and they did that. It's a dying art, the family.
Yeah.
You know, I always tell people there's three things in life. There's family, making love, and the smell of gravy on a Sunday morning. Now, I don't know what, do you call it gravy? You probably call it sauce.
I call it tomato sauce.
In New York, we call it gravy.
Yeah, I know that. Yeah, no, I call it tomato sauce.
Yeah, we call
and
it
I
gravy.
Make it. I cook all that Italian stuff.
It's wonderful. Now, I want to get back into your show and some of the things and some of the. Now you've done other things.
I write. Short stories, which I also like to read as I perform them as short stories. I don't put them up as a one-person show because I write a lot of short stories, and I love the short story format. I like to tell my story and get, you know, the beginning, the middle, and an end, and have it like a complete little package with the bow. So I love to do readings of my short stories. A lot of them also take place in Italy. Some of them are not funny. Some of them, you know, are crazy, neurotic, funny, and some of them are just touching stories. So I also do that, and I perform these short stories. I put four or five together, and I read them. I find that in L.A. it's a little bit difficult. I know in New York it's a little easier. Right. People talk about that, you know, they tell me that. Because in L.A. people really need a package. They need to know where your show is going. Is this good for a sitcom? If not,
how's it going to make money?
Yeah, how's it going to make money? And yeah. I just love to let people, you know, like Spalding Gray reading his pieces.
Right.
I know I've had friends say, well, you know, I can't sit through something like that. And I go, well, but they're great stories. A story is a story. A movie is a story if it's told well, you know,
right.
if it's well written. So it's all a story. And my grandfather was the biggest storyteller. This was my big form of entertainment, was my grandfather, who just died a year ago on July the 4th. He was 96 years old, Calabrese. And he was the big storyteller. He didn't, he'd say, oh, don't watch TV. Okay, and then he'd start telling you a story about his days in the military. And they would all be like these epic stories. He was the best storyteller. He couldn't read, he couldn't write, and he could not sign his name when he died. You know, but he was a great storyteller, and he would just hold court with all these great stories. I mean, that's a great form of entertainment.
That's how it started.
Yeah, so that's, I got that from him. So I love to do this short story format, and then I also write screenplays, and I do perform. You know, I do, if I'm cast in a play, I like to be on stage, but I do also do voiceover.
Do you? Oh, you. That's a hard field to get into, then.
Yeah, it's.
That's a hard field to get into.
It is. I do voiceover and in English and Italian.
Oh, that's wonderful. And what about doing Italian looping out here?
I do. I don't actually
for English,
do.
I mean.
Yeah, I don't
do
actually.
Italian version.
I used to do the dubbing in Italy, but I don't actually dub here where you dub from, where they use my voice as an Italian. But I've worked on a lot of feature films out here where I did Italian. There's a film that I have a very big voiceover part in called The Core, and it's all in Italian. It's a big voiceover, so I do a lot of Italian. I just did a spot for Pepsi, which I don't know if I was allowed to say that, but it was an Italian. It's a spot for Pepsi, I'm a character in the spot, and I do an Italian, Italian verse in it.
So you're really established and you know, really working. We got to get you into Actors Studio though.
Mm-hmm.
I gotta get Mark Rydell. I gotta get him to see this because you do belong in the writers directors unit too,
mm-hmm.
and they have that which opens up. And you know, being an observer at the studio, you do belong there.
Well, Susan, it's funny. When I first moved out here, Susan and I were working together. We were still working together. I'd go back to Italy and do this the stages, as they call them there, their workshops. And Susan was saying that to me, and I said, Susan, I really don't know if I'm staying in Los Angeles. I had a career in Italy. I was working there, so I thought, I really don't know if I'm going to stay in Los Angeles. And she kept saying, well, honey, let me know. And
yeah, well, God, because, I mean, I'm going to say this. I think you're going to be a gift to Actors Studio and to us out here. So with your knowledge and your background, and your love, I can see that. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you're really committed to the work.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we are at Actors Studio. You know, that's what Susan,
absolutely.
The work.
Yeah.
You know, when we watch Salome Jens, and you ask her, how do you do this? She said, I do the work.
Yeah.
And that was an incredible performance that she gave.
She was wonderful. The first words came out of her mouth,
yes.
She had me, because her voice was so powerful, and it was like,
And people today don't train with their voices anymore. They think they're so used to microphone. People don't train today. They want to be movie stars, not actors.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what it's really about. And then someone like yourself comes along. I mean, we really need people like you. And I'm not saying that because you're Italian. I would, but We do need people like you who know what the work is about, who's been there, because it's a dying art. And if it wasn't for people like you to bring your stuff, it's just going to go away. So we really need you. Is there anything special you want to say before we go? We got about a minute.
I just wanted to say that I know you're Italian, and this is not something I usually get to say, but I'm really proud to be Italian. Oh. Growing up, I wasn't. I lived in a very, let's say, we were called the W word.
Yeah. And stands for without papers.
And so I was embarrassed, and I didn't want my name to be Dina, which is my real name. I wanted it to be Darlene. So I said to my mother, don't call me Dina anymore. My name is Darlene. I want it to be so white bread. And when they spoke to me in Italian, I would say, excuse me, and I would pretend I didn't know who was. You know? And then the older I got, the more I realized, boy, this being Italian is really important to me. And I was in a beauty pageant when I was 16 years old, and the host of the show asked who was from an ethnic background, and I said I was Italian. And he started asking questions in Italian, and I was so embarrassed and so intimidated to answer in Italian because I didn't think my Italian was good enough. And I said, that's it. I have to be proud to be Italian. And so when I do my show now, I'm really proud that I'm doing it. There's a lot of Italian in my show. And the fact that I'm blonde and have blue eyes and do not look Italian has worked against me. But it works against a woman because they go, she doesn't look Italian. She doesn't look Italian. And so it's only when I finally put my show up on stage that I had, you know, reviewers come up to me or audience people that I didn't know say, are you really Italian? But you're blonde and you have blue eyes. I go, yes, I'm really Italian and I want to stay like this. I want people to see that there are other kinds of Italians out there.
We'll feed the birds, and it does cost nothing to be nice, and that'll take us out. But just keep talking.
Oh.
I'm proud to be Italian. I tell you, hey, listen, we're wrapping it up.
Well, my mother said to me once, I said, Mama, should I dye my hair dark so I look like you? Because my father has blonde hair and blue eyes. And she said, no, be exactly who you are. In Italian, she's saying this to me. Be exactly who you are, because someday people will get you for exactly who you are.
That's all we have.
Yeah.
Do not forget that you're Italian.
That's right. Well, when you see my show, you'll know that I'm not forgetting that I'm Italian. It's all there.
Was it dreams ago? My heart felt this glow. Are only just tonight.